Every business, regardless of size or stage, has to excel in generating new leads as it directly relates to potential sales and profits. This becomes very important every month and is the main struggle most freelance copywriters face. With Million Dollar Copy, we address this struggle by showing you how to find and manage your leads and clients, how to pitch and close deals, and you'll even learn strategies and tactics in leveling up your business to a potential seven-figure business. Million Dollar Copy has 7 modules. The first and second module guide you on generating new leads and managing them so you can deploy your resources effectively and efficiently. The third and fourth module help you find your competitive edge by creating your unique selling proposition and your unique offer. In the fifth and sixth modules, you'll learn how to pitch and close deals and scale your business onwards and upwards. The final module, the seventh, is for starters and seasoned copywriters to learn the fundamentals and secrets of copywriting through the Killer Copy Blueprint. Unlike other products out there teaching people how to be a copywriter, Million Dollar Copy focuses on finding clients and building the copywriting business. In Million Dollar Copy, the strategy is to create raving fans for your business. To do this, it starts with the ability to generate leads, and this is represented by the lead generation funnel. Leads turn into prospects, which then in turn become clients, and those clients turn into raving fans. Leads are defined as suspects for your business and turn into prospects after meeting certain criteria or qualifications. Yes, they need to be qualified to be your customer because not everyone is your target audience. Prospects are your potential clients, whereas actual clients have agreed to engage with your services and money has been transferred to your account. Raving fans promote your services positively, fervently, and free of charge because of the results they've gotten from you. Raving fans help to lower your cost of advertising because their free positive review helps generate new leads for you. This is also referred to as a positive opinion leadership. Not every client will turn into a raving fan, but every client has the potential to be your raving fan. It comes down to how well you serve and impact your clients and the experience they have with you. There are 5 lead generation tactics you can use. Lead generation tactic number 1, use what you have at where you are. If you're just starting out, begin with what you have at where you are. If you are already in business for a couple of years, look at your surroundings and identify untapped opportunities. How do we execute this tactic? First, pull out a map and locate where you are. You can use Google Maps or search for free map tools or a physical map. Draw a circle with a radius of 15 kilometers from where you are. Why a 15 kilometer radius? Because it's about a 20-minute drive from where you are. This takes less time driving and gives you more time for getting leads and clients. Next, list down all the businesses within the radius, and now you've got a list of potential leads to start with. It would be businesses with different backgrounds and sizes. To manage this list, categorize them as small, medium, and large businesses, and identify the top 3 potential clients. To identify the top 3, do your research. Here are 5 ways you can do it. Note if the potential lead is a brick and mortar establishment like a restaurant. You can always visit their location on the busiest day of the week to get a feel for their business. For example, restaurants would be lunch or dinner services Friday, Saturday, or Sunday, clothing stores during weekends, clubs during Fridays, Saturdays, and ladies' night, and corporations by the number of staff employed, which you can determine by the number of people exiting the building during lunch hour. Yes, you will not get an absolute number, but it gives you a good gauge. This tactic is interesting because it gives you access to your leads as you can pinpoint their location and can drop in at an appropriate time to pitch your services to them. Visiting their establishment also hones your skills of identifying opportunities to add more value. When you're done identifying your top 3 potential leads, approach and pitch your services using either of the following methods. What you want to do is fix an appointment, meet up with them, and say you've done research and have got a proposal to share to potentially double or triple their business in the next 3 months. Appointments can be fixed by dropping your name card or through a cold call, or get someone to do a warm introduction to the owner of the business. However, if you're just starting out, start from the bottom 3 potential leads and offer to work for them for minimal charges or for free in exchange for a video testimonial, which you can then use on your website to market your services. Why video testimonials? Well, it's more powerful, influential, and convincing than a written one. When you're done with the first 3 clients on that bottom 3 of your lead list, move up the ladder to medium and larger clients. Note that when dealing with the bottom 3 clients, There will be opportunities and challenges in the form of educating them on the importance of copywriting. They're at the bottom three for a reason, and they may not even have the funds to pay for minimal charges. Therefore, the strategy here is to win small first and get results as soon as possible so you can use those results to generate more leads and approach bigger clients. When you're just starting out, you want to get clients and results fast so you don't go hungry and you can keep the business going. Lead generation tactic number two, cold call your way to a hot success. Contrary to what people believe, cold calls do work when done under the right context. This is an extension of tactic number one. To deploy this tactic, draw up a list of potential leads and call them up on the phone one by one. Don't email them, as it may go to the spam folder. Also, don't show up right at their doorstep, as your leads may be running on a busy schedule and could find it very intrusive. Calling on the phone is less intrusive and gives you the opportunity to build rapport. The goal is to set up a face-to-face appointment so you can better persuade and influence their decision to engage with you. What you want to do is, on the phone, first introduce yourself, then set the context by saying you've done research and have identified X number of opportunities to further improve the business, primarily through copywriting. You're keen to work with them, and if they're open to explore the proposal, you would love to meet up in person on either timing A or timing B. Always give them options to help expedite the meeting. Otherwise, they'll say they're too busy and they'll get back to you, well, they'll say they get back to you, which often takes a long time if it ever happens at all. If one call isn't successful, move on to the next until you do succeed. When you've gone through your list, expand the radius which you set in tactic one to find more leads. Lead generation tactic number three, your network is your net worth. It's not only who you know, but who knows you. To do this, you want to add value to the people you meet and want to do it with sincerity and authenticity. Not everything needs to be about sales. The intention is to build long-term relationships, and the reason for this is because people do business with people they know, like, and trust. These relationships can lead to a warm introduction to potentially something bigger and better. Never underestimate the power of a warm introduction. It's important to note, not all networking events are the same. So at most events, you end up with people who are like you, wanting to meet potential clients and selling all the time. The tip here is to be clear about the event and add value to the people you meet. Don't waste your time by going to all networking events. Be clear on the goal of the event first before going to it. Check out local establishments like Business Network International. They're an international business network with local chapters where only one unique service or business can join, and business is done on referral basis with zero commissions. Other platforms you can consider looking at are PTIX or Eventbrite. These are online platforms where event organizers post details of their event. Some are free and others are paid. Here's a power tip for business cards you bring to networking events. Most people distribute their name cards like flyers. You'd want to only exchange business cards with potential leads. A tactical move is to have an odd-shaped name card so it stands out from the rest of the standard template name cards. On your name card, include a web link where your leads and prospects can download a bonus or tips in exchange for their name and email address. This way, you can build your email list, which you can mine later. Be sure to organize your list and ensure you do a follow-up. The bonuses offered can be used to your advantage, and you can even use different bonuses for different kinds of leads. Your bonuses offered can also be used as a conversation starter. For example, you could talk about how to 10x your sales through persuasive copy, or 10 big mistakes every business makes, or even copywriting secrets for small, medium enterprises. Do a follow-up on businesses that download the bonus by sending them an email or over the phone. What you can say is, "Hey, I've noticed you've downloaded this bonus. I'm dropping in to check if it has served you well and if there are any questions in its implementation." And this is how you'll want to get one foot in the door and utilize the leads you've gotten from networking events. Lead generation tactic number four, freelancer mega platforms. Upwork is an online site where clients and freelancers match up for a job. This works well because jobs posted up are automatically qualified as prospects, as they are actively searching for freelancers. However, the competition is steep, and if you haven't built a name or a portfolio online for yourself, clients will typically pick the cheapest price or the highest perceived quality. This is where your previous results from tactic 1, 2, and 3 come into play. You can use those results and post them as part of your portfolio. As a client and freelancer myself, I've noticed most new freelancers on Upwork wait to be hired online instead of also focusing on offline clients. They'll state they're new and offer fees lower than the standard rate, hoping to score a client so they can get results. I typically avoid these types of freelancers because they're cheap and don't value their own services. Look for high-paying clients through the search filter. Jobs categorized as expert level have bigger budgets, but are also more complex and with higher expectations. One way I've used to stand out from all the other applications for a job when I don't even have an online portfolio is to do a video application. You can do this by recording a self-introduction through a video and addressing the client by name. In the video, present how you'll tackle the job and what you can deliver for the client. This tactic honestly takes little effort and requires less than 15 minutes to produce, but leaves a lasting impression because you're most likely the only applicant to send in a video application. Also, now there's a face to your name. Your prospects have gotten to know you better than the rest of the applicants. Now you're equipped with 4 proven tactics to help you generate leads. Remember to always over-deliver and add value to the people you meet. It'll be tough at first, but you will reach a tipping point where clients will start looking for you instead. The game of freelancing is a fast-paced game, especially if you're working on your own and if you don't have a dedicated team assisting you with marketing or servicing clients. You've got to be smart with your time and resources. The last thing you want to do is be slow in responding to new leads and be far too occupied with existing clients. It's important to have a system on managing your leads, otherwise you'll end up confused and cluttered. This clouds your focus and you won't be able to prioritize your clients. Where your focus goes, your wealth flows. Here are 3 lead management tactics which you can deploy. Tactic 1, categorize, organize, and prioritize. You've gained momentum and results, and now you're getting an influx of leads and prospects who are interested in your services. To manage them properly, you need to categorize, organize, and prioritize based on a system which works for you. The reason for this is so you can identify and manage your time and resources better. This will also enable you to manage your cash flow well, because cash flow is king. So, how do you do this? First, you want to organize all incoming leads and existing clients into small, medium, and large clients. The reason we're doing this is because we want to have a healthy mix of small, medium, and large clients to ensure we have uninterrupted cash flow to the business. Next, put a definition on what small, medium, and large is. This is usually defined by profit. If there are no details on profit, then go with annual revenue. Profit is a good measurement because it indicates a healthy marketing and advertising fund in your client. Small clients may not have the budget to invest in advertising and marketing. They have little to no red tape and bureaucracies to deal with. Therefore, this allows for quick approvals and feedback on the work, as you're typically dealing directly with the business owner. Small clients may not place high importance on copywriting and may have mindset and mental blockages which don't make them open to invest in copywriting. They're small for a reason. However, they are great to start with to get initial results. The strategy to win with small clients is to work for minimal charges or for free in exchange for video testimonials. Medium clients are somewhat more flexible than big clients. They also have a bigger budget for advertising and marketing compared to smaller clients and typically have a better mindset. They're more competitive and desire to grow bigger, of course. The strategy here is to focus on retainers and grow with medium clients. Retainers are long-term contracts across an agreed duration, and because it's long-term, there's a tendency for it to be lower than a one-off service. Think of it as a bulk sale. Big clients have bigger budgets for advertising and promotions, hence they're able to pay more for high-quality copywriting services. Internally, they have a lot of processes to go through before the copy can be approved. This means some projects can take longer than expected to complete, or there's a lot of waiting time in between submissions and feedback. This can result in multiple changes and tight due dates, which can create a lot of stress. Which is why your competition are creative and advertising agencies, which provide full service and have account management executives to deal with the clients, while the creative team works in the background to meet the creative brief. Some big clients also practice a 60-day credit term with service providers like copywriters. This, obviously, can highly influence your cash flow. The strategy is to have a healthy combination of short-term, or small, mid-term, medium and big, and then long-term clients, made of the medium and big clients, because you want uninterrupted cash flow and multiple businesses. Lead management tactic number 2, pre-qualify your leads. There are many different leads. Some genuinely want to engage with you, others are just exploring, trying to find the best yet cheapest copywriter to engage with. Which type of clients do you think you want to work with? This is a very important question to ask because you only have 24 hours in a day, 8 of which are spent sleeping, 3 hours on breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and balance maybe 13 hours to work if you're cranking out full speed. But let's be honest, copywriting is a creative process and creativity can't be forced. And there are so many distractions like other people, coffee, Facebook, and the like. The point is you can't spend time on leads and clients who waste your time. So you've got to pre-qualify them. How? If they came from your website, you can set up an automatic form which captures the main details of the company. Next, you want to pre-interview them on the form by asking relevant business questions. Keep it to maybe 3 or 5 questions. This helps you to identify their main problem and spot opportunities for the client. You may sometimes find the solution to their problem may not be solved with copywriting. And if the solution is in other areas, you may want to team up with another freelancer or consultant to address the business problem. This helps you to add more value to your clients. The main aim is to pre-qualify your leads to determine if they are serious about hiring a copywriter and if they're in a good financial standing to do so. Avoid leads and clients who are cheapskates and time wasters. Lead management tactic number 3, nurturing your leads. In the beginning, you actively search for new leads and qualify them if they're in need of copywriting services. As your business grows and your perceived value increases, you become more and more in demand. Leads that turn into clients are managed like any other clients. However, leads that don't turn into clients, the best tactical move is to filter out those who are interested but did not engage with you due to budget constraints. For these leads, it pays not to disqualify them immediately because they may not have the budget now, but in the future, who can tell? Maybe they will. Therefore, the strategy is to serve them with a downsell in the form of an ebook or information which they can use at their leisure. Follow up with them as a low priority to check if they've implemented it. When they start getting the results they want, guess who they'll go back to? Well, obviously, you. Don't lower your fees to match your lead's budget because it cheapens your value. It's harder to raise your fees because the mindset of the lead is like, if you could do it before for so cheap, can't you do it again? However, if you must lower your fees in special situations where the client shows potential growth, make it clear and upfront to the lead that it is a one-off situation. This is not your regular price. You could also negotiate for a percentage of profit of the additional sales generated as a compensation. Also, avoid leads who promise future work if you lower your fees for just this one project. Based on experience, I can tell you, these promises are rarely kept. Lead management is important because your resources are finite. If you want to build a $1 million business through copywriting, you need to manage your most important resource of all, which is your time and energy. Spend your time working on sales-generating activities. Where your focus goes, your wealth flows. In every market, there are businesses out there competing for customers' attention and sales. If they have a bigger advertising budget, they'll shout and promote louder than you, so much it drowns out your voice. Therefore, as a copywriter, it's important to know and develop a differentiation in your service and what you offer compared to your competitors. This is so you can stand out from them. To do this, you need to define and focus on building your unique selling proposition, or USP for short. A USP communicates the difference in your service between you and your competitors. This helps to influence, persuade, and convince leads and potential clients to choose your service. Without a USP, your services would look the same, and just like every other freelance copywriter out there. And clients who don't know any better will have the tendency to select the lowest fees or the highest perceived quality in order to save costs. A USP is important because it helps to cut through clutter. It forces you to focus on your specialty relevant to the market. You see, your resources are finite. Your time and energy needs to be managed well, especially if you're operating as a solo entrepreneur. This means you need to focus on what you do best and not be everything to all people. If you try to be everything, you'll eventually burn out and it dilutes your perceived value of your services. Also, note the ones who charge highly in the market or have the highest prices. They're usually experts who specialize in just one area. So, what is your specialty? To develop your USP, first, you'll need to identify who your competitors are in the market. You need to know the environment you're playing in, where you stand, and of course, the rules of the game. Generally, there are 3 types of copywriters, which are entry level, mid level, and high level. Entry-level competitors are like yourself if you're just starting out as a newbie in the copywriting scene. Most likely, they'd be fresh graduates or would have accumulated about a year or more of copywriting experience working in an agency and have just started to branch out on their own. They have little to no client base. For mid-level, they're competitors who have 3 to 5 years experience in the field and have a list of recurring clients. They could be operating with a mix of new clients and/or existing clients with retainers. Retainers are where the clients retain and engage a copywriter on a long-term basis. The payout is more consistent, however, it may be at a slightly lower rate than a one-off engagement. And high-level competitors are experts who typically charge higher because of experience and results. It also covers full-service advertising agencies and boutiques. Full-service agencies typically manage the full component of advertising and marketing, covering above and below the line advertising. They'd have a client servicing team or an account management team, a creative team, and a production team. Boutique agencies, on the other hand, may handle only a specific component like research, creative work, or digital advertising. At this level, clients are normally larger corporations with bigger advertising budgets. Expectations, of course, are also higher with more complex engagements and longer time to push a project forward because there are many levels for work to be approved. Once you've mapped out your competitors, next, do an analysis. Questions to ask and find answers to will be based on how they operate. What are the pricing structures like? And are they affordable or is it too expensive? Who are their clients? What are their success stories? And what are their strengths and weaknesses? And questions you as a copywriter should be asking yourself are, what are your opportunities? What are the threats to your business as a copywriter? And are there gaps in the market? What problems are you solving in the market? After finding out the answers, you'll be able to have a clearer understanding of your business. The main aim, of course, is to understand the rules of the game and know which rules you can bend or maybe even break. You can't play the game if you don't know how it works. After your competitors, next is to analyze and understand your potential clients and cover their demographics and psychographics. In this case, psychographics would reveal more insights. Demographics are quantifiable qualities covering age, gender, income, education, and economic status, and they help you to develop quick insights as to how your leads and clients operate and where to target them. Psychographics, on the other hand, are insights based on attitudes and lifestyles and other psychological criteria. Psychographics help you to understand the needs, wants, and expectations of clients towards the services of a copywriter. Combining demographics and psychographics would generate a key insight on your potential leads. For example, you find a majority of your leads who inquire about your services originate from a certain city, and based on interviews with past clients, you can find input and opinions are valued and copywriters are expected to have some strategic marketing and sales experience, for example. So with that information in hand, you'd want to focus your adverts to target that city and potentially position yourself as the strategic marketing copywriter, possibly even branding yourself as such because that's what clients in that city are looking for, if that makes sense. This approach can also be used when analyzing the target market for your clients' businesses to help you create relevant and persuasive sales converting copy. At this point, you'll be able to identify a gap in the market. A gap is defined as an unfulfilled need or want in the market where you can leverage and dominate it. Next is to develop your USP to fit the market gap and turn it into a positioning statement. An effective one, when communicated, either offers a solution to your client's problem or communicates your differentiation point. This is developed based on your earlier research. Examples of great USPs are Avis, we're number 2. M&M's, the milk chocolate melts in your mouth, not in your hand. De Beers, a diamond is forever. Your positioning statement is to be specific and as simple as possible. Once you're done, next is to communicate your USP. You can express your USP through a tagline. It's a short phrase or sentence which serves to give a clearer message about your service as a copywriter. With the USP and tagline, you can further communicate it by having it consistently appear across all of your marketing materials, like your name card and website. This moves on to branding yourself and having it appear consistently, right up to the way you talk and carry yourself with your audience. Branding helps to elevate the perceived value of your services. The more valuable your brand is, the more you can charge clients for your services. For example, the cost to engage with marketing guru Jay Abraham starts from, get this, $50,000 just for a keynote speech. In short, as a copywriter, being great is not enough if nobody knows you. You need to know how to market yourself. In a crowded marketplace, a unique USP will cut through clutter and noise. It also helps to build up your branding, and in the long run, lessens the cost of advertising to capture new leads. In the previous modules, you've learned about generating and managing leads, finding your unique selling proposition, and communicating it. Here in this module, we'll cover crafting your secret offer, also known as the proposal, to present to your leads and potential clients. It's a secret because they only know your offer after they've been pre-qualified. You don't want your rates to be publicly known by your competitors. There are three sections in creating your secret offer. The first section is, where is the business at? The second section is, what can I do for you? And the final section is, how much is the investment? Section one, where is the business at? Before you start, ensure that you have the necessary formatting and standard information. These are your company logo, address, contact number, email, website, and date of proposal. After that, start off by highlighting the situation of the business. Write this section using a point A to B formula. Point A is where the business is at currently. Point B is where the business wants to go. Ideally, keep it to two paragraphs, with the first paragraph as point A, and the second paragraph, you guessed it, as point B. This helps with clarity in your communication. These points are obtained from the research done on your leads in Module 1, Lead Generation Strategies, where you observed your lead's business, did online research, or interviewed them. Point A to B can also be expressed as problem and solution. Point A, of course, is the business problem or challenge, and point B is your proposed solution. Section 2, what can I do for you? This section is about what you as the copywriter can do for your lead or client, and is divided into three parts: objectives, measurements, and strategic options. Objectives are aligned and agreed upon in previous meetings. It's then listed according to priority to demonstrate your clarity, understanding, and focus of the proposal. Ideally, there should be at least three objectives with a maximum of five, because too many objectives becomes unrealistic and loses focus. Objectives are to be written in an actionable statement with a clear end result. For example, increase website conversion rates by 12% within 60 days of campaign launch. Here, you know exactly what your role is, which is to produce the copy that converts an additional 12%, and you've got up to 60 days after the campaign launch to do it. After setting the objectives, you must have a way to measure success. Otherwise, you won't know whether your copy is underperforming, performing, or overperforming. This is important because if your copy is overperforming, you'd be in a better position to negotiate for a bonus or higher fees the next round. It also looks really good on your portfolio. Some clients don't track their marketing results, so be prepared to allocate additional manpower to track the results of your projects. The measurements proposed is a picture of what success looks like. Next, do up a projected estimate of what the end results would look like in value and numbers, meaning should they hire you, what is the minimum result that can be achieved? Sure, nothing is guaranteed, and you need to reiterate that, but leads and clients need to know this because it answers their doubts, and also it makes it easier for them to have the proposal approved internally. The estimates are conservative because you want to set this up so that you overdeliver consistently. The areas where you need to estimate are areas like sales, monthly or annual, conversions, clicks, and open rate. This part is the most important part of Section 2, and it's here that you demonstrate your value and expertise as a copywriter. In this part, propose at least two, with a maximum of three options for your client to choose and achieve the business goal. Option 1 starts with the bare minimum, and the next option after that is a buildup of the previous option. The reason you're doing this is three-pronged. First, you're showing your thought process and that you're able to think about strategy and execution. Second, you're giving your client flexibility to choose based on their marketing and advertising budget. Third, you want to be able to do more for your client because doing more equals adding more value, equals more business, equals future repeat business. Next, state when you can start and how long it will take for the project to complete. This helps you and your client to manage your own respective timelines, as you or your client may be in the middle of another big project that's demanding. Finally, end this section by outlining roles, responsibilities, and accountabilities for both yourself and your client. This part needs to be clear and concise to avoid miscommunication and ensure that all gaps are covered. Section 3, how much is the investment? In this final section, it's all about pricing your services. You should always refer to your professional fees as investment, because the word fee implies money paid, whereas the word investment implies money paid now, which gives returns in the future. There are three ways to price your services, which are time, deliverables, and value of the project. The best way to set the investment is according to the value of the project. This allows your professional rate to match the project regardless of if it's a low or a very high value. It also gives you the flexibility to approach clients of different levels. Do state your payment timing as well, whether it's a 30-day or a 15-day payment schedule, or a half payment up front and balance half payment after project has been completed. To entice your client to pay in full up front, you can consider including a 10% rebate as a reward. Finally, end this section with your signature and a space for your client to sign and seal a deal. The necessary details are name, signature, and date. Hello, hello. Welcome back to another module from Million Dollar Copy. In this module, I'm going to show you how to close a deal in 8 steps. This formula will help you close virtually any sale. And remember, this 8-step formula, de-closing. There are 3 sections to this formula. The first section is the deal. The second section is the client. And the last section is the close. The first step is D, which stands for deal. You first need a deal, which we've covered in Module 1, Lead Generation Strategies. The next challenge is to get the prospect to take action and actually engage with you. The next part is with the assumption that you've secured a meeting with your lead. The second section, also referred to as CLO, is where you engage with a lead or prospect. This is the part where you interact with the client and listen to what their wants and needs are. Don't immediately propose your cost of services, because you don't want to be seen as a money-minded person or money-grubbing or greedy. Remember, through listening to your clients, you'll get the necessary information to help you closing the deal. So bring a pen and a paper to the meeting to take down notes. This helps you to spot opportunities to sell your copywriting services at the right time, but definitely not at the beginning. The third section is known as the sing, S-I-N-G. This is the time that you, quote, sing your worth to your leads and clients. Before you sell your company or services, you first need to sell yourself. Know your value well, and speak with conviction of your ability and of your services and the ability of your services to solve your client's problem. There are 3 main ways to secure and convert your potential prospects into clients. The first method is called the decoy effect. When people are faced with a third choice of a strategically priced decoy, they're more likely to choose the less or the mid expensive of the other options. Here's how it works. When you have 2 options, clients are coaxed to make a decision. They can choose the one option for less money or the other option for more money. It can be perceived as a tough decision. They want more quality but don't want to spend more money. So what do? Enter the decoy effect. The decoy effect pricing involves adding a third option, the decoy. It's priced closer to the more expensive option, suggesting that the more expensive option is actually better. This means you can use this in your business by setting up different packages for your copywriting service. After listening to your potential client's needs and wants, you can then customize a package for them. For example, a basic package might cost $5,000. Then come up with 2 more packages with other services you can offer. Now, it's not to say make up random packages or fluff for that matter. Your next 2 packages proposed need to add value and help to achieve the client's goal at 2 or 3 times more than what they asked for. So how do you come up with what to include in those packages? Well, obviously, listen to the client's needs and wants. Both packages are at different prices and more expensive than the basic package, but the services should be an extension and add higher value compared to the basic package. Before you present all 3 packages, first set the context. Tell your prospect you've listened and analyzed their needs and wants, and you'd like to present 3 solutions to help achieve their business goal, with 2 options of potentially doubling or tripling up their results. And then you move on to the pitch. And here's what happens when you present all 3 packages. By its own, that $5,000 package looks pretty expensive. However, when you put 2 more packages, with one at $10,000 and the other at $15,000, the first package of $5,000 now seems more acceptable and, in fact, reasonably priced. Why? Because a comparison happened. Use this psychology to your advantage. The second method is the rule of reciprocity. By virtue of the rule of reciprocity, people feel obligated to repay favors and gifts in the future. How this can help you to get more business is to provide free service to selected leads and ask for a video testimonial in return, which can be placed on your website and serve as social proof for the results of your services. You want to get video testimonials because they're more convincing and engaging compared to written testimonials. In the video testimonial, you get to see the expressions, emotion, and authenticity of the person giving the testimonial. Therefore, the convincing power is higher. Do be careful, though, on giving too much away, and know when to draw the line to avoid the situation of being taken advantage of by clients who ask too much. The third way is to utilize scarcity and ask your prospects to act now to close the deal immediately. Scarcity is the state of being scarce or in short supply. Psychologically speaking, we place a higher perceived value on an object that's scarce or limited in nature, and a lower perceived value on those things that are more abundant because they're always there and we can take them for granted safely. The thought of wanting something we can't have drives us to desire that object even more. So how can you apply this in your business? One way is to set up a seasonal promotion for your services and publicize it by sending emails to your prospects. When you're more established, you'll be in a better position to state you only have a couple of slots left in your work schedule. Therefore, your leads or clients will need to make a decision soon before those slots are taken up. The reason for this is so leads and clients don't take up too much time in deciding, as of course it interrupts not only with your productivity, but also your cash flow. You could also consider rewarding those who are fast action takers who engage with your services on the spot or within a short period of time. You can reward them by offering a lower price or add in some additional bonuses. If you offer them a lower price, don't label it as a discount, as the term discount lowers the perceived value of your services overall. Instead, label it as a reward for taking quick action. What you'll notice is your leads and clients are being educated to act fast and trained to act when you ask them to. And if they pass the due date that you've set, of course, you need to stick to your guns and raise the price again. If you don't, they will know the next time you deploy a scarcity tactic, it's just for show. When attending meetings with the client, remember first impressions count. I'm not saying you should dress in a tuxedo or anything, but a good rule of thumb is to dress decently and appropriately. Include body language to show you're confident and you're open to suggestions and ideas. Small talk like asking questions to find mutual interest is a good way to keep the overall conversation going. Next, influence your lead to put their trust into your services. Instead of fees or price, rephrase these words as the cost of investment. And it's true. Your service is an investment, which generates sales and covers back the investment cost in the long run. Fees and price gives the perception that it's costing them something they can't get back. Be authoritative and offer opinions and suggestions. People are more likely to follow a suggestion or recommendation from someone they consider an authority on the topic. Not many people would question a domain authority, especially in a face-to-face conversation. Therefore, in order to influence your prospect, you must appear as an authority figure or a guru to them in the field of copywriting. Suggest methods, frameworks, tips, and other tricks which will help grow their business, and do it without expecting anything in return. You want to use this opportunity to demonstrate your worth and value to your leads and clients. And of course, as you're suggesting this, you can cleverly slot in examples of how your services add value and solve their business problem. Ask questions about their business to help them develop the genuine sense that you care and you're interested in their business. People buy from people they know, like, and trust. Once the prospect agrees with the deal, formulate a plan to negotiate for payment. Here, you negotiate the terms of payment. You want to have at least 50% upfront payment or other benefits, such as profit sharing at a certain percentage from the sales generated as a result of your sales copy. It's important to request for upfront payment because you might be working with someone you don't really know for the first time, and there's little to no trust between you and the new client just yet. This can prevent you from getting burned, and clients who pay for an upfront payment are far less likely to pull out from doing business with you halfway through the deal. Upfront payment also keeps the cash flow moving, and again, cash flow is king. If you're a freelancer, your income may not be stable all the time. Sometimes leads or clients may cringe at the word of upfront payment, so maybe just rephrase it to the word commitment before the work starts. Here are 7 steps to close the deal effectively. Step 1, Help the lead or client unlearn previous bad experiences. Everyone will have had at least one bad experience with a copywriter, and your job is to convince them that you are different. Number two, respect your client by accepting opinions and having an open discussion with them. Number three, sell benefits. Sell yourself, then sell your company, and you must first convince yourself that your service can solve their problem. Step four, read buying signals by analyzing the client's company financial status and observing the client during your pitch. Interest is typically demonstrated when they lean forward to listen closely and when they ask questions. Number five, create a sense of urgency. Get prospects to act on this, and it can be done by having limited seasonal offers or buying before the price increases. Number six, handling clients' remorse. Clients who've made an expensive purchase in the past are more likely to experience buyer's remorse if the results they were delivered did not meet their expectations. And of course, if this happens, they'll feel as if they've been cheated. To mitigate this effect in your pitches, consistently deliver on the quality you promise. This strengthens the feeling that they've made the right choice and increases the likelihood of a repeat purchase in the future. And number seven, follow up. Send emails and calls to keep track of your client's business performance and suggest little ways for improvement. If you want to close as many sales as possible, one size does not fit all. Here are five different closing techniques you can use for your future sales. Number one, the assumptive close. This technique is used as if the prospect has already made their decision. Turn the focus of the conversation towards the next series of questions, such as, how many do they want? When do they want it? Or even something like, would you like to make payment in cash, card, or check? Technique number two, sell your services with love. Use this technique to show your prospect that you're passionate in the work you do. Salespeople with the highest energy win. Energy comes in the form of enthusiasm and actions. Number three, the Ben Franklin close, also called the balance sheet close. Use this technique to list the pros and cons of doing business with you and ensure that the list of pros is longer than the cons. Technique number four, the hard to get close. Use this technique to convince your prospect there's a limited time to your discount or promotion, and it's on a first come, first serve basis. Reward prospects that act fast to do business with you. And number five, the little mistake versus big mistake close. Use this technique to emphasize not doing business with you is a big mistake. The prospect is given a choice where the downside risk is so high that the only logical decision is to do business with you. Otherwise, their business will be at high risk. After you've sealed the deal, the final part of the formula is gain. This happens once full payment is received. Following the purchasing process, the sale doesn't end after payment. There are three steps you need to do after closing the sale. Number one, establish a timeline for the purchase. When to receive payment, if it's a payment scheme, and when your services will start. Number two, follow up with the timeline closely to make sure everything is going as planned. Reminders for payment need to be done to ensure the client follows the purchasing process, and then you close the deal within the agreed timeline. Number three, keep in mind, the sale doesn't end after payment is received. That's just when it starts. You'll reach a stage where your schedule is filled up to its maximum capacity, and you'll be balancing between looking for new business versus writing copy. At this stage, you will have gained expertise in generating and managing new leads, managing existing clients, and writing great copy. Can you alone make $1 million? Yes, totally possible. If you charge high enough, at $50,000 a month consistently, you'll be a millionaire in about 2 years, more or less. However, in exchange, you might reach burnout stage sooner than you think, which at the end of the day really kind of isn't worth it at all. Instead of a one-man show, a better way is to set up a team to do the delivery for you while you focus on sales-generating activities like marketing, generating new leads, pitching, and networking. To do that, you need to be working on your business instead of in your business. If you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, you need a team, is an old African proverb. Most copywriters get stuck in freelancing when they do everything themselves. For some, they end up hating the entire process because they do things that don't fit their creative selves, like the financials of the business. Some even get stuck working extra long hours. And here's the irony. They built a business in the first place to get more time and financial freedom, yet get swallowed up in the business. You need to be working on your business, meaning strategy, direction, and high-level thinking. The strategy to do this is to simplify, automate, and systematize the business. Streamline tasks by keeping things simple, organized, and straight to the point. Automate tasks that can be automated and build systems, processes, and standards where managers are hired to keep the system running. There are five main steps to simplifying the business. First, write down in detail all the tasks that you have to do on a daily basis. And this means everything from processing payments to writing copy and even meeting clients and taking out the trash. Second, categorize it into two categories, transactional and transformational actions. Transactional tasks are rudimentary in nature and are predictable. For example, processing salary, paying bills, rent, etc. Transformational tasks, on the other hand, bring positive impact to the business. For example, business development, staff training, personal development, sales and marketing activities. The reason we're doing this is to have clarity and prioritize what to focus on, what positions to hire, the required job scope for those positions, and the matching salary based on the value they bring to your business. Third, analyze the list and eliminate tasks which are redundant, double entry tasks, and simplify the complex ones. To do this, you need to be disciplined and ruthless. The aim is to be lean and fast. Fourth, lump transactional tasks together and outsource them or hire an administrative staff to take care of it. This is so that you can focus on transformational tasks only. Lastly, hire and retain staff that can do transformational tasks like you. People are not assets in the classical sense, but the right people can be assets to your business. So don't be afraid to cut those who are not a good fit with the company. The ones that do fit and work well together in the team should be retained for the long term. So what is the ideal team size for your business? It's recommended to start with between 5 to 7 people. It might seem like a lot, but this is to maintain team dynamics at a higher level. Unless a solid context is set at the beginning, a team that's too small will operate on taking orders only, and it becomes very transactional and operational. You'll have to be physically there most of the time to manage them, and opinions that really matter and help get things done won't be voiced. You don't want that to happen because you want your team to speak their thoughts, debate, and challenge you in healthy ways. It's only through that process that you'll be able to spot and cover gaps in the business and overall do better. A yes man or surrounding yourself with people who say yes to everything is definitely a no-no. In the team that you hire, keep a healthy balance between operational staff, creative staff, and managers or supervisors to keep the systems running and the standards in check. This will free up more time for you to start thinking on a high level and work on your business. Get clear on who you want and what positions you want filled. You can do this from the list of tasks, which you did earlier on. It depends on your preference if you want full-time or contractual staff, or you could even outsource certain rudimentary tasks to keep costs low. In terms of hiring, my recommendation is to go with long-term contracts. You may also want to consider having profit sharing where the team can leverage off of the business name and the success that you've all built. This promotes empowerment, staff loyalty, and you'll have far less staff turnover. This also means less training time and time lost during the period of hiring and interviews. There are three key areas in managing and building an A team. The first area is culture creation. Culture is important as it sets context and tonality for your company. It governs mindset, attitude, and behaviors, which ultimately influence your sales and your profits. If a company culture operates on low energy and nobody talks to each other, what do you think the end result is? Well, definitely, the result of the work is mediocre. To set an effective high-performance work culture, you need to set rules, often referred to as the code of honor. To do this, gather the team together and list down the desired attributes, attitudes, behaviors, and results that the team needs to practice in order to be able to achieve those company goals. Filter out the unnecessary, combine, and then boil it down to a list of 8 to 10 rules that, when practiced and upheld to the highest level, should set the team into high performance gear. An example of one of these rules might be rule number 1, commit to learning and personal development. The second key area is learning and development. If the team is not learning and growing, they are dying. Therefore, your team needs to sharpen the saw, to use the quote. Out there in the marketplace, there are other copywriters and businesses who are working harder, smarter, and quicker than your team. If there's no growth in learning new things or developing current talent, then one day the gap will close and your competitors will surpass you. Stay ahead and competitive by structuring learning and development activities for your team. For example, a session where the team presents 15 minutes on a topic that adds value to the team. If there are 7 people in your team, there would be a total of 105 minutes presented every month. Annually, it would be 84 topics or 21 hours of learning time. This is very good compared to other teams out there who are often too busy to even sit down and read. The third key area is to debrief. After the completion of a project, debriefing is the most powerful learning tool to use as a business owner. Debriefing is the activity of evaluating a recent project, and the goal is to identify gaps and insights to better prepare for the next project. You'll need to schedule in another meeting session with your team, and this is critical. Imagine not doing a debriefing and starting the next project. The same mistakes could be made over and over again without even realizing it, and that is just insane. Your role during the debrief session is facilitator, and it's to be done without bias or rank. The following questions are designed to facilitate insights from your team. 1. What happened? 2. What should have happened? 3. What did we learn? 4. How can we improve? 5. What are the action points from this session? At the end of the session, you'll have action steps that the team can take to become better. These steps can be to stop, start, do less, or do more of something. The final part of leveling up is managing your financials. If you don't know how to manage it, then it's recommended to hire or outsource that to someone. As a business owner and the person in charge of your team, you need to know your financial numbers to evaluate if the business is healthy. The strategy is to minimize your expenses through operating lean while you maximize your profits through sales and marketing. To do this, you must have someone to monitor the cash flow of the company. Unnecessary expenses are identified from the task list created at the beginning of this module. When you cut those out, you cut down your expenses. All businesses generally have 3 main divisions: marketing, production, and operations. In the case of a copywriting business, creative work is considered as both production and operations. Upon receiving revenue, pay your staff first and yourself last. This is to take care of the engine of your business, your staff, and keep it running. In the long run, it will pay off. After that, pay for what's necessary to keep operations running, like office rent, utilities, and other bills. With the balance as net profit, allocate 10% of your funds to grow and develop the team. This will cover sending qualified team members to seminars, workshops, investing in books or training videos, and do this strategically with a specific outcome. Allocate another 5% to invest in the team for rest and relaxation. The team cannot be running around 24/7, especially when it comes to creative work. The mind needs to rest and to unwind, and funds are needed for that to happen. There are business owners and team leaders who don't allocate any playtime for their team to recharge, and that encourages them to burn out, and it makes people bored. When fund allocation is done in percentage versus value and the team is empowered and has ownership of their work and actively contributes to the company, all that needs to be done now is to increase the productivity and marketing of the company. More revenue brings in more profits, brings in more funds for learning, profit sharing, and rest and relaxation. Welcome back to another module in Million Dollar Copy. This module is for beginners who are starting out as copywriters, and it's also for those who are seasoned copywriters. We'll be covering on how to write an effective and excellent copy. Let's get started. In order to write effective copy, it has to capture attention and also be able to amplify the interest of your target audience. It also has to create desire by empathizing with them on the problem that they're facing and propose or produce a solution to solve their problem. Your copy must include a call to action for your audience to take, which can vary from signing up to an email list right up to purchasing something immediately. Here are the important elements of an effective sales copy. First, you must have a headline, subheadline, and introduction. The headline is the most important element, as it's the first element your audience reads. It's the hook for them to read and explore further into your sales copy. The headline is recommended to be big and bold to grab attention. For web copy, the font size is recommended to be around 50 to 54 points. Next, the subheadline is where it's used as a follow-up to further explain the headline. Remember that subheadlines are to complement a headline and is read kind of as one. Keep it consistent to the context set forth in the headline. Think of the subheadline as reinforcing the headline. Next is the introduction. This is where you introduce yourself and your company, because others might not know who you are or what business you're running, especially for new leads. Here, you tell a story that must be relatable and relevant to the problem faced by your target audience. The story that you share helps to establish your credibility and earn the right to provide a solution to them. People buy from people they know, like, and trust, and this part is just that, which is getting to know you better. There are many story plots you can consider. The top three recommended are Rags to Riches, The Quest, and Voyage in Return. In Rags to Riches, it's a plot about how a person was poor before this, and then managed to get rich after discovering or doing something in particular. For example, you can tell the story about how you were poor in the beginning, and pushing a 9-to-5 job just like everyone else. And then you decided that enough is enough, and you went on to take massive action. The result is that you are a millionaire today and have retired rich. The Quest covers going out to attain or achieve something, and you faced many obstacles and challenges along the way. For example, you survived a near-death experience, and it was through that experience that you realized that life is important and that you're meant to do something bigger, and that is to set people free and live life on their terms. It has become your obsession and your quest to learn the keys to success and share them with everyone. Voyage in Return is where you go to uncharted territories, faced many challenges, and returned with experience. This can be venturing into a new business where you faced many challenges, and now that the business generates 6 figures a month, you now return with experience and would like to share the secrets with your audience. Stories are powerful. We grow up as children being captivated by stories, and it's really not much different as an adult. A power tip is to use your story to seed the offer or solution that you're selling to your audience. For example, in your story, you can seed about finally cracking the formula and generating 6 figures a month. Then in your offer or solution, you can either offer a formula as a product, which requires your audience to purchase to get the information, or you could offer it as a bonus to induce purchase from your audience. Either way, because you've seeded that idea in the beginning, that story has now gained power and credibility. This is how you want to seed using your story. Then, after the story, present a solution to the problem mentioned in the introduction. By solution, I mean your products or services. You do this by listing out the features and the benefits of your products or services. Really, you should sell benefits instead of features to your target audience by educating your audience on how the product or service can solve the problem they're facing. Remember that features tell, but benefits sell. People are not interested in what your product or service is about, but how it helps them solve their problem. Also, include testimonials in your copy. Social proof is the key to hypnotic selling. An excellent example of social proof is a video testimonial by your former clients that you've helped achieve results for. This increases the level of trust and confidence in you. Now, in video testimonials, there's a format that you can follow. Don't leave it up to your clients to give you a testimonial because most likely they don't know what to say when facing the camera. You need to guide them so that the quality is consistent. The format to follow is this. First, share their name and what they do. Then, tell what problems they faced before they engaged with your product or service. Then share what was achieved as a result of engaging with your product or service. Finally, share what the result was after 3 months of using your product or service. This format is designed to produce top quality testimonials, which are relevant and convert well for you. The understanding behind testimonials as social proof is the, quote, just like you factor. If a past client who is just like your audience can achieve these results, then it stands to reason that's the most likely outcome for your new audience. This is the thinking that goes on in the mind of your new leads. It also helps to lessen the risk of trying out something new. Next, incorporate handling objections into your sales copy. This element aims to answer the doubts of your target audience. For example, time taken or the cost to achieve the desired result. Here, explain why your product or service is worth the amount of investment. Reassure your audience that they've made the right choice and minimize the risk by offering a 30-day money-back guarantee. At any point within 30 days of the product purchased, if your customers decide that it's not for them, they can always send it back and get a refund. Now, this doesn't work for every product or service out there in the market as it varies. So what you want to do is, with this knowledge, adapt it to your business. A money-back guarantee is good because consumers feel their interests are protected and secured, and it's less risky. This helps to remove their doubts and fear. After that, put in a call to action. It's an instruction to the audience designed to provoke an immediate response. For instance, an imperative verb such as find out more or even something like claim your free trial. Last but not least is the postscript. This is the second most important element in a copy after the headline. Recap what the entire offer is all about and emphasize the benefits, how your product or service can help solve the audience's problem, and also the guarantee. Notice that the important elements are the first and last to appear in copy. This is due to the primacy and recency effects, which are under a larger umbrella called the serial position effect. Studies suggest that humans are more likely to recall the items at the beginning and at the end than items in the middle. Therefore, it's crucial to recap your offer at the very end of your copy. In order to sell your services to your customers, you need to have some basic knowledge on consumer behavior. There are two types of desired customer reactions, which are the required outcome and the appropriate experience. When the needs of the client are met, it's known as the required outcome. When the customer's experience is congruent with the customer's expectations, it's known as the appropriate experience. Customer success is achieved through the customer's interaction with your company. Next, provoke the audience's emotions by telling a story that relates to the pain that they are facing now and agitate that problem. This is so that the prospects know that they're not alone and your service can help them solve the problem. Explain your offer with clarity, as this gives your client confidence to do business with you because you know your value and business well. Recap your offer at the end of the meeting due to the serial position effect. So, why do you need to know this as a copywriter? Because if you ignore your customer's behavior, you ignore the opportunity for them to relate to you. People buy from people that they know, like, and trust. The feeling of trust is formed from knowing and liking first. To tie it all up, start with generating leads and clients and managing them to your highest degree. At the same time, you need to know how to cut through competition and noise by developing and communicating your unique selling proposition. Finally, pitch and close your clients and build a team around systems and processes. Rinse and repeat the same strategies and tactics to scale your business. Good luck.